गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन, वेलकम टू गाइड आईएएस। दिस इज योर होस्ट हितैषी। आई होप यू हैड अ वंडरफुल वीकेंड। सो टुडे वी हैव वेरी स्पेशल पर्सन विद अस एंड द कॉन्वर्सेशन इज रियली गोइंग टू बी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड इंसाइटफुल एट द सेम टाइम। एंड आई मस्ट से दैट अ सरप्राइज अवेट्स यू। टू नो इट एंड ग्रैब इट, यू नीड टू स्टे विद मी टिल द एंड। सो विदाउट एनी फर्दर डिले, लेट्स डाइव इन। So guys, joining us today is a man, a civil servant who speaks his mind, who's known to be witty and wise. His illustrious career speaks volumes about him. The gentleman who says, by being honest, you are not doing anybody a favor. He is none other than our former secretary to the Government of India and a retired IAS officer, Shri Anil Swaroop sir. So with all the love and joy in our hearts, let's connect with him.
Oh, very good morning, sir.
Very good morning to you as well, and to all your viewers.
I hope you are doing great.
I'm fine, yes.
Oh, welcome to Guide IAS, sir. It's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for joining with us. So, before we begin with the conversation, I want to give a quick sneak peek in your journey so far. So, guys, during his career of 38 years, sir has attempted to make it happen. Born in Allahabad, UP, he earned his master's degree in political science from Allahabad University in 1978, where he was awarded the Chancellor's Gold Medal for being the best all-round student. Before joining the IAS in 1981, he served as an IPS for a year. He won Director's Gold Medal for Best Officer Trainee at Labasna. As a civil servant, he held various assignments within both the state and the central government. During the final years of his career, he served as secretary to Government of India in the Ministry of Coal, handling the aftermath of the coal scam. Thereafter, he served as secretary, school education and literacy, where he attempted to foster public-private partnership to improve quality of school education. And now he is an established author with his two phenomenal books out. So, yeah. So, okay, sir, we'll begin with the questions that would take you down the memory lane. So, the very first one. So, back in the days, that is in 1980s, you know, when the sources were very limited, there was no internet. In fact, I would say that the people were not that aware of UPSC as a field or as an exam. So, how was your preparation back then, the difficulties you faced, and what was the motivation behind?
First of all, thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to interact with youngsters like you. I look forward to imbibing a lot of energy from those that are participating here. Now, way back in 1979, when I started preparation for my exams. In those days, as you rightly said, there was no internet. But the fun was going to the library. I used to spend a lot of time in the library. My father was posted in Aligarh. So I used the Maulana Azad Library of Aligarh Muslim University. I spent a lot of time there. Taking out books, reading them. It was a different sort of learning. Right now, all the material is available at the click of the button. There you had to read many books and then hunt it out. For us, it was slightly more difficult than it is now, because in 1979, the Kothari Commission report was implemented and the examination pattern was changed totally. Earlier, there used to be 5 papers, 2 higher and 3 lower. And now it was reduced to 2 subjects, each subject having 2 papers. I gather that now it has been reduced to 1 subject, but during our time, 2 subjects, 4 papers. So I had done my master's in political science. Obviously, I took political science as one of the papers, but dusra, the second subject was a difficult choice. And I finally chose law as a paper. The reason was that some of it I had studied in political science, like constitutional law and international law I studied, but others I could study. It was a huge challenge. But in a competition, the advantage is, others also face the same challenge. If it's a differential challenge, then there's a problem. If everyone is facing the same challenge, you get a level playing field and it's not a problem at all. I enjoyed those prepared days of preparation. In fact, I learned right through my life that if you start enjoying what you're doing, it doesn't appear as a drudgery and the chances are that you'll succeed. That was the initial lesson of my life. I benefited out of it when I was preparing for the civil service. It was tough, but I enjoyed it. And by God's grace, in the first year, I qualified for the police, which I thought was a failure. And so was my dad. Now, where did the motivation to get into the civil service come from? You ask this question. And that got answered in my books, in fact. The motivation came from my dad, actually. My father wanted me to become an IAS officer. It was his dream. And I made it into my dream and appeared. Let me tell you that even at that point in time, the craze for IAS was still there. People are aware now. I think they were always. Economy had not opened up. Now, of course, there's so much available in the private sector. In those days, not much was available in the private sector. So everyone wanted to become an IAS officer, especially from the areas that I came from. I came from UP, and these states like UP, Bihar, Odisha, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, all these states, many students wanted to become an IAS officer.
Okay, sir. So the next one, sir, as we know, you won Director's Gold Medal for Best Officer Training at Labasna. So that means the foundation for accomplishments had been already laid there. So I am sure that there must be many memories related to Labasna in your heart. So any particular you would like to share with us, which you'll never forget?
This medal came as a surprise to me because I never tried for it, so to say. I mean, when we joined the academy, initially it was all fun. First 3 months, it was called the foundation course. And I distinctly remember that I used to keep awake during the night, singing and music sessions and jam sessions. And in the class, I used to sleep more often than not. So I have very fond memories of not doing anything there. Yet I went on to win the Director's Gold Medal. I think those who gave me that medal would be able to answer better why they gave me this medal. But I enjoyed every moment there. I keep using this word, enjoying the moments. And I keep telling youngsters and my colleagues also, so long as you're enjoying the moments. And I have some very, very fond memories of those 3 months. They perhaps were the finest of my lifetime. You know, you got into the service that you wanted. There was no pressure on you, no examination, and you could have a whale of a time. We had a wonderful village visit. We had a trek to Badrinath and Kedarnath. Wonderful, wonderful time that we had. And we used to mimic our directors and deputy directors. Almost every week we used to have a mimic show. And I used to mimic a lot of them. It was good fun that we had in those 3 months.
Great, sir. So moving on, sir, this is the question that is asked very frequently, that language, especially while communicating, is a huge problem for youngsters these days. You know, most of the people can't communicate in English fluently. So they tend to lose their confidence there and then. And as you also faced a such situation, but then you won the first national debate prize. So how was your journey from a language barrier to the first winning prize?
I'm glad you asked this question because I was not a born debater. I was not very fluent in speaking. When I did my class 12, I had physics, chemistry, maths as my subjects. So when I joined and took over humanities as my subjects in bachelor's in Allahabad University, I could barely speak or write any sentence in English or Hindi. I mean, I could write one or two, but not very coherently. So I decided to go ahead and set up a drill to improve my language. And now when people come to me, youngsters come to me, I suggest this drill to you. And this drill is very simple. Every morning you pick up the newspaper, pick up the editorial article, read it aloud. Now, those around you will make fun of you that what are you doing, because it is not usually the done thing. But I did it. I did it very regularly, read the editorial article aloud every morning. And after some time when my diction improved, I used to put the paper down and then speak out those ideas in my own words. In those days, we did not have tape recorders. We had very unusual type of tape recorders. Today, it's much easier. You can tape it on your phone. So I suggest to everyone, do this drill regularly. And then, of course, you have group discussions, participate in the debates. I think I have quoted in my second book that there was a debating competition in the hostel where we stayed and I forgot what I had to speak. So after 10 minutes, I had to walk off the stage. But these are the problems that you have to face when you evolve as an individual. And I think every individual commits a mistake. Every individual has failures in life. Ultimately, successful are those people who are able to learn from the mistakes and failures. I was learning regularly from my mistakes and failure. Initially, I used to feel very sad and bad. I remember as a youngster, till class 7, I did not win a single medal or a trophy or a certificate. And I used to feel very, very frustrated. My mother used to tell me, don't worry, your time will come. And then she used to also say, Karmanne vadikaraste ma phalichukaraj. And I'd never understood the meaning when I was youngster then. Later on in life, I discovered how thoughtful, how meaningful are these lines. Because I gradually came to this conclusion that I have no control over results. I have only control over my action. I have only control over my present. And that helped me phenomenally in my life. Initially, I didn't understand all that. So I again tell youngsters, if you don't succeed at a point in time, don't worry about it. So long as you are enjoying the journey, so long as you are enjoying the moment, success will come. It has its own time. And in any case, you don't have much control, or for that matter, any control over results. If the results are positive, it's an icing on the cake. But if you continue to enjoy moments, that is it.
Yes, sir. So the next one, sir, there was a time when you were in the midst of riots, agitations, curfews, demolitions. A lot of confusion was going around you. That is the case of Babri Masjid. And handling such a sensitive issue actually needs courage, because, you know, it needs you beyond your governmental or political space as well. So how did you manage that?
You know, over a period of time, as you continue to experience different situations, you start also learning how to handle them. And as I said earlier, I knew if I did things correctly, that was the final thing that I wanted to do. I had no control over results. I distinctly remember I was district magistrate Lakhimpur Khiri, and things were quite fine till a time when a district president of the ruling party decided to take out a funeral procession as a person has been murdered. Now, the situation was very charged on account of Babri Masjid agitation. So I requested him not to take out that procession, telling him that it is his own government and there could be riots if that happened in a charged environment. But he didn't agree and he insisted on taking out that procession. So I had no option to put him behind the bars. Now, this was not normally done, you know, head of the district president of the ruling party, you normally don't put him behind the bars. But I did. I told my wife that I could be transferred on account of that, because that had been my experience earlier. So in the evening, the chief minister rang me up and asked me why had I put his man behind the bars. So I explained to him and he didn't appear very satisfied. But he still asked me what can be done. I told him, sir, either you speak to him or somebody from Lucknow speaks to him and tells him that this is his own government and if a procession is allowed, there'll be riots. So he didn't appear very satisfied. He put the phone down. But next morning, I got a message that the gentleman is prepared not to take out the funeral procession. So I released him. I thought things have been done. But 2 months down the line, the chief minister gave me the reward of one of the best district magistrates in the state. Now here, I had not expected that again, because I had put the district president of the ruling party behind bars. And to be rewarded as one of the finest district magistrates came as a surprise to me. I had not expected it, but I got it. Well, I loved it. It's not that I also love rewards as others do. But my expectation levels for rewards had come down over a period of time. So whatever came my way, I enjoyed those moments. So it was tough.
Yeah, indeed, sir. So the next one, sir, as a civil servant, there are various points, or I should say circumstances, where you are trapped between the political pressure and your personal will, which you know that the personal one is ethically correct as contrary to the political one. So how do you tackle such situations?
You know, first of all, I have always felt that my value system may be different from that of anybody else, including a politician, a friend in the family. Value systems can vary from person to person. Now, how do you come to a conclusion regarding taking action? In government, it is fairly clear. In government, if there is a law or a rule, then ethics should not come in the way. You should do what the law or the rule says. It's very clear. I have a different value system. I will have to go by what the law says. If I dislike it, if I do it, I resign and then do what I want to do. So long as I'm a civil servant, I'll do that. Same applies for a politician. If a politician is telling me to do something which is legally correct, then I will try and do it. Now, if there is no legal ban or approval, but I consider it ethically wrong. So, for example, a politician tells me to suspend an officer. And there is an instance given in my book, if you've read it, that when I was Secretary of Horticulture, there was this minister who sent me a written order asking me to suspend a deputy director for which he was authorized. He was legally correct. Now, normally what a civil servant does is carries out the order, suspends the officer. But when I got this order, I discovered that he has not given any reason. He just asked me to suspend the officer, two-line order. So I rang him up to ask him, sir, no reason has been assigned. You want me to suspend this officer? What could be the reason? He said that he has not come to meet me. Now, that I found very funny, because an officer not meeting the minister should not be the cause for suspension. So I told the minister, sir, I'll ask the officer to meet you. Should not be a reason for suspension. We didn't have any further conversation. So I found out about this officer. And everyone told me that he's an honest, efficient officer. So I was wondering why he's not met him. So I rang up the officer and asked him, why didn't you meet the minister? He's very upset. He wants to suspend you. He said, sir, I met him on a number of occasions, but the manner in which he wants to meet me, I have not met him. Now, this minister was extremely corrupt. He wanted money from this officer, and the officer was not willing to pay. Now, that was a dilemma in my mind. The politician wanting me to suspend him, and my value system said that this officer needs to be protected. Now, what do you do in such a situation? So, I found out a rule which said that if I disagreed with the minister, I could prove the files with the chief secretary. So, I spoke to the chief secretary and gave him all the background. He agreed with me. He said, file based on him. So I sent the file to him. Now the minister did not speak to the chief secretary. He went and met the chief minister. I don't know what transpired between them, but I was transferred up. So that was if you call it a price that I had to pay. The chief secretary is very upset. He called me. He said, "Tum usko bachane ke chakkar mein tumhara transfer ho gaya." I said, "Sir, kyun pareshan hote hain? For a civil servant, transfer is like death. It is inevitable. Now something which is inevitable, why worry about it? And in any case, I believe in Hindu philosophy. You're not going to throw me out of service. You're going to post me somewhere else." So he got me posted somewhere else and I worked as I did. So the point that I'm trying to make here is that sometimes there are occasions where there is a conflict between your value system and what you are asked to do. Then you have to take a call. It's a personal call. And you have to be prepared for a price to pay for that. I never regretted it. In fact, I have always protected the officers that I worked. Always. And that helped me in my service, because the officers were totally committed to my cause, what I wanted to do. And much of this little success that I achieved during my career was on account of this fabulous team and the trust that we had in each other.
Okay, sir. So, the next one, sir, there occurs conflict of interest in the services. So, what's your take on that?
I don't see any major conflict. I mean, if you give me an example, I'll explain to you. But I never found any conflict. I was very clear. It is all your own clarity of thought. If you are clear in your mind and your value system you're clear, then there is no conflict of interest. I never came across any conflicting interest in my career. I was clear what was to be done, what was not to be done. And if I was overruled by the politician, then I went about doing what the politician said, because my job was to inform him, to guide him. If he overruled me, fair enough. There were many instances in my career where the politician overruled me and I had to go by it, because we live in a democracy. Ultimate decision is that of the politician, so long as what he tells me is not illegal. If it is illegal, there's no question of my doing it. There's no overruling in it. But in administration and in our service, it's a huge gray area. There's a lot that is very clearly laid down that this should be done, this should not be done. But there's a lot of gray area where you have to interpret a rule. And in that interpretation, if the minister overrules you, so be it, you go by it.
Yes, sir. Sir, next, we all know the role you played in the gangs of Wasseypur, that is, as a coal secretary in the coal scam. But I really want to know, as per your experience, what are those minute things that happened even then and which are still, you know, which still persist even now, due to which governance is a challenge even now?
You know, one of the biggest challenges that I faced as school secretary was not these scams. the biggest challenge was the shortage of coal supply. Because if there was no shortage of coal supply, these problems would not have existed. Everyone thought scams are a problem. Now, India has 300 billion tons of coal, 300 billion tons as reserve. And our requirement is only 800 million tons. So we can go on for more than 100 years with coal that we have. Yet, we are short of coal. 25 to 30% of coal is imported. Now, this is because of a variety of reasons. The three primary reasons that I looked into was, number one, acquisition of land. Number two, clearances of forest and environment. And number three, evacuation of coal, because this coal existed in interior areas. For the first two parts, that is land acquisition, clearance, the state governments have a very important role to play. So as coal secretary, I did not have a single meeting in Delhi with the state governments. I used to travel to the states. That continues to be a problem. Because unless you take states into confidence, until you take states on board, I don't think you can have smooth coal excavation and evacuation. For that, you have to take states into confidence. That is a problem today. Because sometimes I do perceive, not only in coal sector, but in many other sectors, there is a tendency to ride a roughshod, meaning thereby, there is a tendency to do things as we want it to be done, rather than take states into confidence. One of the brightest, or should not be using the word brightest, one of the darkest example that I have is of farms legislation. Now you have this dharna going around in around Delhi. This would not have, could have easily been avoided had the states, has Rajya Sabha, it would have been taken into confidence in the sense that instead of pushing the bill in the Rajya Sabha, it should have been discussed at length. The state should have been taken into confidence. It is when you don't take states into confidence, because ultimately all legislations are implemented in the states. As I say, center is a fiction. Actual actions happens in the state. And I have always believed, again, if you read my book, I have always believed to take all the stakeholders into confidence. There is bound to be disagreement. It is very natural. The question is, how do we build consensus? That needs to be very heard, understood very clearly. Now, if you don't build consensus, then your decision will not last. I have written in my book that for any idea to fructify, everyone has ideas in this country, but for an idea to fructify and sustain over a period of time, it has to be politically acceptable, socially desirable, technologically feasible, financially viable, administratively doable, judicially tenable. And in the wake of the farms laws, I have added another dimension, which is emotionally relatable, meaning thereby that you have to take stakeholders on board into confidence for doing something which impacts them. We can't sitting here in Delhi treat ourselves as the wisest men around, men and women around. I think there's a lot of wisdom that exists in the states. If we talk to them, we may still disagree, but I think a lot of work gets done. When we did this coal block auction, and especially in the case of coal, today the states where coal exists, there the ruling governance is by opposition parties, meaning thereby West Bengal, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Maharashtra. These are coal-bearing states and all have parties that are non-NDA parties. Now, you can't fight with them. You can fight politically, but as when it comes to economics, you have to take states along with them. And hence, it's very important to take stakeholders, in this case, the states along with them.
Very true, sir. The next one, sir, in your service of good 38 years, any person, he or she might be your colleague, politician, or any random person you met during your journey that left a deep impression on you. Someone like you were fascinated by him or her. So please share with us any such personality.
It is only in films that one person impacts so much that your life changes. In actual life, there's a series of people. So if you starting with politicians, I mean, my interaction with Mr. Kalyan Singh, who was then the chief minister, then my interaction with Mr. Mallikarjun Kharge, who was the labor minister, my interaction with Mr. Prakash Javadekar, who was the education minister, all these left quite an imprint on me and I enjoyed working with them. Similarly, amongst my senior officers, there was Mr. Prabhat Kumar, who was the cabinet secretary, government of India, and later on became governor of Jharkhand. Mr. D.K. Mittal, who was secretary, banking and insurance. There are many officers who had, Mr. Yogendra Narayan, who was Secretary General Lok Sabha. Many officers had impact on my functioning. They were my role models. I learned from them. So it's not, it would be wrong to say that one person impacted my career, my official career. I think I owe it to number of them from whom I learned a lot. Lot many names are mentioned in my book who actually, and not only did I learn from seniors, I learned a lot from my people who worked under me. I mean, there were some outstanding officers I had the privilege to work with. And though I was their boss, but in fact, I was learning from them because I saw them with a lot of poise, with a lot of hard work that they put in. Their analysis on the files was phenomenal. Their drive. So it was not merely learning from my superiors. I learned a lot from those that worked with me or under me.
And that's really great, sir. So next, sir, you are known to be the person who stands with the right, you know, even if that means to put your neck on the line. So, sir, how difficult it is to lead and support your team in crisis because, you know, the world sees the naked problem. No one knows the layers hidden behind.
It came by and large naturally to me right from student days. I thought protecting your team was one of the biggest or the strongest attribute of a leader. If you are unable to protect your team or team member, when you know that he or she is not in the wrong, then you are not doing justice to leadership. So to me, that was an a priori requirement of any leader. That principle I couldn't ever compromise. So if I understood that my subordinate or my colleague was not at fault, I would go any distance to protect him or her, irrespective of what came to me. And again, in my book, Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant, I have narrated a number of instances where I went all the distance to protect the officers, and I benefited enormously because the trust that I bestowed in them was paid back with interest. I have retired for the past 3 years now, and I can ring up any officer who's worked with me, any officer, and he would stop everything else to listen to me and try and follow up what I tell him. That is the trust that I had in them, that probably the trust they had in me. It was like a team that I enjoyed working with. I keep saying that I get a lot of credit for what I did in my career, especially in the later part of my career. I think the credit goes to the fabulous team that I had. I was perhaps the only secretary who used to leave the office at 6 o'clock in the evening. I don't think any other secretary left that, except for the first 3 months as code secretary, where I spent even the nights in the office. But thereafter, I used to leave. I was secretary for almost 4 years, one of the longest serving secretaries. And yet I left the office at 6 o'clock, and work never suffered because the team worked. They knew that they could take risks. They knew that if something went wrong, I was there to support them. And that being the case, they put their heart and soul into it. And I benefited out of it. The organization benefited out.
And this is something we all should learn from you, sir. So the next one, sir, as you said in the book, the purpose of governance is not merely to come up with great ideas and plans, but to make things happen on the ground as well. So, sir, how difficult it is to make things happen because we know there's a whole lot of gap between the document and the ground reality.
I think that one of the biggest problems in governance today is our inability to implement the ideas that we have. So you have policies and policies, ideas and ideas. But the common man on the ground, his sufferings are not taken care of. I distinctly remember when Dr. Kasturi Rangan, who was the chairman of the committee that was formulating the new national education policy, when he came to meet me, he asked me for my suggestions. So my response surprised him because I told him, you're wasting your time. And he was surprised because we had set up that committee. He said, why? I said, I have no problem with the policy. But if your policy does not have a clear-cut, well-defined action plan, clearly outlining what needs to be done, how it will be done, who will do it, by when it will be done, I think your exercise will be meaningless because what the common man is interested in is how a thing will happen rather than what needs to be happened. So we know we have the diagnosis, we have the prescription. It's the application that's where we are missing out. So hence, the focus has to be application. And this, once you start working on the application part, you start also appreciating the limitations of an idea, that whether it is politically acceptable, whether it is socially desirable, whether it's technologically feasible, whether it's financially viable, whether it's administratively doable, whether it's judicially tenable. Unless you look at the implementation part, you have to just suggest ideas which someone else has to implement. And if someone else has to implement, you don't have any responsibility, you can write anything. And that is the problem with a large number of policies, where we find wonderful, wonderful ideas given there, but they never get implemented. It is only when we look at it from the other side and see how that implementation has to happen that you will determine that why it hasn't happened so far, and then try and do things that and suggest ideas that are implementable and doable.
Yes, sir, indeed. Sir, next one, sir. As I was reading about you, I read something related to Nexus of Good. You know, there's a initiative taken by you that runs on a mantra, nurturing positivity. So please tell us something about that. Sure, sir. Sir, as I was reading about you, I came to know about something called Nexus of Good, an initiative taken by you. So that runs on a mantra, nurturing positivity. So we want to know something about that. So.
You know, I was during the last few years of my career, I could discern a lot of negativity around in the society. And when I opened news channel, which I don't watch anymore, I saw that nation wants to know only negative things. The world has either collapsed or it is about to collapse. But I did feel a lot of good work happening around me, especially when I traveled to about 24 states as secretary of school education. I traveled deep inside to look at schools in the rural areas, and I discovered a lot of phenomenal amount of good work being done in the field. It was in that context that I decided to create a platform where good work could be roadshowed, could be shown. The idea primarily was to demonstrate to everyone that good work can not only be done, it is actually being done. So you feel convinced about something when you see it happen, because sometimes you have an idea and you don't know whether it is actually happening or not. For your conviction, for your understanding, it is important for you to see that what is being talked about is actually happening. That is what Nexus of Good is, that you identify good work that is happening around you, you try and understand that good work, you then start appreciating that good work, and after appreciating, you see how that work can be replicated and scaled. It is in the context of replication scale that we also feel that government can play a very important role. Hence, the second important dimension of Nexus Good is public-private partnership. Because I've always believed that a lot of efficient good work can be done in the private domain, but when it comes to scaling, I think the partnership with government is very, very important. We have, unfortunately, in the government, looked at the non-governmental organizations very suspiciously. We feel that all the private sector is making money, all the NGOs are wrong. Similarly, in the private sector, everyone feels that everyone in the government is corrupt. I think both are equally wrong. There are good people on either sides of the fence. The government, there are outstanding people who want to do good work. There's a lot of good work that is happening in the private domain. I have often said, if all the rascals and ruffians can come together and make life difficult for us, why can't good people come together and make life good for everyone? So that's the whole objective of Nexus Good. Through your platform, I would request all of you to take a look at the nexusofgood.org.in portal. And if you find it appropriate, do join the Nexus of Good, because I think we need to spread the good message around.
Sure, sir. I assure you that we all are going to join that, because the rarest of the rare people are spreading positivity. So yeah, it's really a great initiative. Now we'll move to the questions related to the book and the authorship. So guys, first I want to tell you that sir has written another book, that is Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant, which is a must read, I want to say, even if you don't belong to the UPSC community in particular, because it gives insights that help that will help you grow definitely as a person. So thank you so much, sir, for bringing this book out. And the very first question is, what was the motivation behind writing this book?
You know, when I had written the first book, Not Just a Civil Servant, that started because I wanted to talk about a health insurance scheme that I was doing, the RSPY. It was arguably the biggest health insurance scheme in the world, and certainly the only paperless health insurance scheme. And since this was a new experiment altogether and it worked, I thought I'll bring it as a part of a book. But thereafter, I got assignments as Secretary Coal and Secretary Education, which was very exciting. So I added chapters from that experience also. And that is how not just a civil servant emerged. But why the second book? You know, I used to go to the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration to interact with officers of various seniorities, right from the beginning when they joined the service as probationers or officer trainee. Then when they came for phase 2, phase 3, phase 4, phase 5. Phase 5 is officers of seniority between 20 and 25 years. So while interacting with them, I discerned that while the youngsters, when they joined the service, they were very enthusiastic. They were very optimistic. They wanted to do things. But as they went up the ladder, that enthusiasm got lost. It got dissipated. And they usually became cynical. So I tried to understand why. And during the interactions, I got to know that most of them blamed the surroundings, the circumstances, and some of them politicians, for their inability to do what they wanted to do. That enthusiasm was gone. It was a typical case of umr bhar yahi bhool karta raha galib, dhool chehre pe thi aaina milta raha. Now, in order to set the record straight, I wanted to write a book to demonstrate that despite these problems, there are a large number of officers who still perform very well. Now, the choice is with us. We have to see where we seek our inspiration from. From such officers who continue to perform well despite the problems, or officers who give up. And the last two lines of my book sum it up. They say, Khudi kukar buland itna ki har takdeer se pehle, Khuda bande se kut puche, bata teri raza kya hai. Meaning thereby that a lot depends on the concerned officer, because if he so desires, he can still do a lot of work. Now, I wanted to demonstrate that through a number of examples, and hence the second book, Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant. It could have been retitled as Making Things Happen in the Government, because the take is that despite the problems that we have, we can still do things. There are dilemmas, there are problems. As I start the book with this couplet, Mukhtasar si zindagi ke ajab se afsane hain, yahan teer bhi chalane hain, parinde bhi bachane hain. So it is tough. But if you carry on, and there is a poem that I had written, and it appears in both of my books, Samay ruka nahi, hum kyun thehar gaye, abhi to hum chale bhi nahi, phir kyun thak gaye, utho pathik, mat bhramit ho, dhumil andhyare mein, shreshth vahi, jo ghira nahi ho, shanik nirasha mein, jago, jagao, man mat behlao, ek masiha, tum bhi ban jao. So the call is to the officer concerned that you have enormous potential in you. Wake up and realize your potential. That's the idea of Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant.
Yes, sir. So I have no more words to say, but just wow. I mean, I really feel interested. So the next one, sir, in layman's words, dilemma is when you have to make a difficult choice between two things. So if you have to explain dilemma in few words in reference to your book, and in context of being a civil servant, so what it would be?
See, first of all, let me explain the title, the entire title. Yeah. What is ethics? Ethics is your value system. And I've always believed that individuals may have different value system. And that is why in my book, I don't talk in terms of anybody adopting the value system which I had. I have questioned some of my decisions at the end of each chapter. Dilemma is a choice. When you have alternatives, you have to take a call as to what is the right one. And that dilemma gets resolved through your own personal value system. So long as there's no disconnect between what you think is right and what you do, I don't think there will be a problem. Problem arises when there's a disconnect. To give you a totally different example to illustrate what is this. You know, I've never understood why people buy Mercedes car. Mercedes cars cost anywhere between 80 lakhs and crore. An equally good car costs about 10 lakhs of rupees. I have a Baleno auto transmission and I love driving it. And the tragedy is most of the owners of Mercedes car don't drive it themselves. So the pleasure of driving goes to the driver. You sit in the back seat and if you close your eyes, you can't make out much of a difference between that car and any other car. By and large difference. In fact, I find Mercedes very inconvenient because it's low seat. But still people buy it. Why do they buy it? They buy it for their neighbor. They want to show to the world that they have a Mercedes car. That is where the problem is. If you do things as per your requirement, if you do things what you deem correct, then I don't think there is no disconnect between what you think is right and what you. When the disconnect comes in, there is a problem. And that's where we are unable to decide clearly. The dilemma is that you are not going by what you think is right. You are trying to weigh some other things and take another decision. Once you look inwards, you'll always come to the right judgment and take the right decision.
Yes, sir. I agree with you. The next one, sir, I really want to ask, as we all know, UPSC has got a GS4 paper, that is ethics. So how helpful this book is going to be for the candidates or aspirants to understand ethics specially?
One of the reasons of writing this book was for GS4. In fact, the publisher of the book, Unique Publishers, they run a coaching institute. And they actually approached me to write this book to give live case studies to candidates, to aspirants, to understand their dilemmas, to understand ethics. One is the theoretical understanding of ethics. I can explain that to you in 5 minutes. The other is understanding the essence of ethics and values. That get understood when you take a real life situation. So about 70 case studies are there in the book. And if one reads them and tries to understand and attempts to answer the questions at the end of each case study, then the understanding of ethics and values will improve. And I would believe that the aspirants would be able to attend to the case studies that come in the examination easily.
Thank you, sir. The next one, sir, aspirants these days feel very nervous thinking of UPSC interviews. So any tips you would like to give them?
I am actually guiding a few aspirants who qualified for the interview. This afternoon, I am talking to quite a few of them. My suggestion to them is improve your articulation, because as you prepare for the written exam, you are not speaking at all. You are actually reading and writing. For interview, you got to speak. So improve your articulation. I have a full drill. I mentioned to you, how do you improve your articulation? Secondly, understand what the board wants. It's not an interview, actually. In an interview, knowledge of the interviewer or the person who's being interviewed is assessed. Here, knowledge has already been assessed. Here, the board is looking at other attributes, how positive you are, how articulate you are, how logical you are, how reasonable you are, how rational you are, how cogent you are. There are other attributes that are being looked at. So I distinctly remember in the second year where I probably got the highest in the country in the interview, 25% of the questions I said, no, I don't know the answer. So they probably liked the candid response. They liked the honesty of my admitting that I didn't know an answer. I never tried to answer a question which I didn't know. And whatever I knew, I expressed my limitations of what I knew. So they want that. They appreciate the fact that you are not supposed to know everything. And if you admit the fact that you don't know everything, it helps you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for this suggestion, sir. So with this, we are done with the questions. Now it's the time to unwrap the beautiful surprise. So guys, we are announcing a giveaway for this phenomenal book, Ethical Dilemmas of a Civil Servant by Sir. The 8 lucky aspirants would get this book, which will carry Sir's autobiograph. So the details of the giveaway would be announced in the evening today. So stay tuned. Thanks a lot, sir, for sharing with us this book. Beautiful one. And also thanks a billion for sparing some time from your ultra busy schedule for us. The conversation we had today inspired me a great deal, and I'm sure it's going to be very inspirational for thousands of the aspirants out there. Your lively experience will help them grow in person. So please accept our heartfelt gratitude, sir. We are eagerly waiting for your third book to hit the shelves. Best wishes, sir. Have a very nice day.
Thank you very much. God bless you. Take care.
Thank you so much, sir.